Good morning. Welcome to worship today as we gather this week. It is the fourth and final weekend in our consecration series for 2021, Disciples Living as Grace-Filled Stewards. And so today we're going to talk about this topic as we've been engaged in this series for a few weeks now. And this week, disciples who are living as grace-filled givers. And we've been kind of leading up to this, so don't leave yet. We're going to talk about that aspect of stewardship as we've been talking about other aspects of stewardship throughout this series. And today we're going to hear from the prophet Malachi as the Lord invites us into a challenge with God. And we're going to also hear from 2 Corinthians as some kind of famous words, God loves a cheerful giver. And what happens, though, if I'm not very cheerful? Does that mean I don't have to give? We'll explore those questions today. We will have the Lord's Supper today in our divine service, so make sure you picked up a communion cup as you came in. Those were on the table, the communion table there as you entered in the sanctuary. And you just tuck those away for now. Pastor Leach will invite you to take those out and have them ready when it is time. I think now it is time to start our worship service, so please rise for the invocation. Brothers and sisters in Christ, we gather today for worship in the name of the triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you. God's beloved, let us come before God, our Father, with repentant hearts and confess our sins to him, asking him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ that he grant forgiveness to us. For God's word says, truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Free indeed. Let us reflect in silence upon God's word for self-examination. Together we confess, God of mercy, I know that I am sinful by nature. I sin against you in what I think, say, and do, in ways that I know and in ways of which I am unaware. With lack of faith, I hesitate to be generous towards God and others, not trusting that he will care for all of my earthly needs. I ask for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, to forgive me for this and for all the ways in which I have done wrong against you. Upon hearing your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and by the command of Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Congregation may be seated.
Almighty reigns.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray together the collect of the day. Heavenly Father, you have called us to be disciples and to make disciples. And so by the power of your Holy Spirit within us, help us to follow your Son, denying our own interests and loving your people more than ourselves. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. As Pastor said, the Old Testament reading that greets us this morning is from Malachi, the third chapter, beginning in verse 6. For I, the Lord, do not change. Therefore, you, O children of Jacob, are not consumed. From the days of your fathers, you have turned aside from my statutes and have not kept them. Return to me, and I will return to you, says the Lord of hosts. But you say, how shall we return? Will man rob God? Yet you are robbing me. But you say, how have we robbed you? And your tithes and your contributions, you are cursed with a curse. For you are robbing me, the whole nation of you. Bring the full tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And thereby put me to the test, says the Lord of hosts. If I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour down for you a blessing until there is no more need. I will rebuke the devourer for you so that it will not destroy the fruits of your soil. And your vine in the field shall not fail to bear, says the Lord of hosts. Then all nations will call you blessed. For you will be a land of delight, says the Lord of hosts. Your words have been hard against me, says the Lord. But you say, how have we spoken against you? You have said, it is vain to serve God. What is the profit of our keeping this charge or of walking as in mourning before the Lord of hosts? And now we call the arrogant blessed. Evildoers not only prosper, but they put God to the test and they escape. This is the word of the Lord. Our epistle this morning greets us to Paul's second letter to the Corinthian church, beginning the 9th chapter. The point is this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. As it is written, he has distributed freely, he has given to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for the food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way, to the generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. For the ministry of this service is not only supplying the needs of the saints, but is also overflowing in many thanksgivings to God. By their approval of this service, they will glorify God because of your submission, flowing from your confession of the gospel of Christ and the generosity of your contribution for them and for all others. While they long for you and pray for you because of the surpassing grace of God upon you, thanks be to God for his inexpressible gift. This is the word of the Lord. Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 21st chapter. Jesus looked up and saw the rich putting their gifts into the offering box. And he saw a poor widow put in 2 small copper coins. And he said, truly, I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all of them. For they all contributed out of their abundance. But she, out of her poverty, put in all she had to live on. This is the gospel of the Lord. Hearing the gospel of Christ, we confess our common faith using the words of the Apostle Creed printed on the screen. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell, and the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Each one must give as he has made up his mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Later on, Paul writes, "For the ministry of this service is not only supplying the needs of the saints, but it is also overflowing in many thanksgivings to God. By their approval of this service, they will glorify God because of your submission flowing from your confession of the gospel of Christ and the generosity of your contribution for them and for all others. While they long for you, they pray for you because of the surpassing grace of God upon you. Thanks be to God for his inexpressible gift." Here ends our sermon text for today. Grace, mercy, and peace from our God and Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Disciples living as grace-filled stewards. Disciples. That's how this whole thing started. If you think back a few weeks, if you've been with us throughout the series, we started with a conversation about what it means to be disciples. A disciple, that word that means to follow, to listen to obey. Whether it's the moral teachings, the spoken words, the moral code. And so we are disciples of Jesus. Disciples who follow the words of Jesus, the teachings of Jesus. And disciples, that's how this whole thing starts. That's how any conversation about our life as stewards has to start. It starts with faith in Jesus. And so you and I have faith in Jesus. And that faith then compels us to this conversation about stewardship. I know, whenever pastor starts mentioning words like stewardship, you just start to kind of, you can feel like pastor's hand reaching into your purse, your pocketbook, to take out your wallet, and, you know, because we're going to start asking for money, right? Well, I hope you've been with us and you've been listening closely, because we haven't talked money yet. Because stewardship is so much bigger than money. Stewardship is so much bigger than your offering, your giving. If you've been with us, you've heard kind of the outline I'm going to share with you here. That stewardship is simply receiving the gifts of God, giving him thanks, and then using those gifts according to his purpose. And so we start with the message of our salvation, right? That gift that God gives us, that gives us forgiveness of sins, that gift of God that is ours, we receive that, we give him thanks for that, and then what do we do with it? We share it. We share that message because we are stewards of that message. And so a few weeks ago then, we were disciples living as grace-filled ambassadors. Because God has reconciled the world to himself through his son Jesus, and he has given us a message of reconciliation, and so he has sent us as ambassadors for Christ. What happened? We received the gift from God, we give him thanks for it, and then we share it with one another. That's stewardship. Last week, Pastor Joe talked about being servants, right? Servants of God. What happens? Jesus came to serve us, right? The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. Jesus came and served us. We give him thanks for it, and then we follow that example and we serve others. Stewardship. Well, now, dear friends in Christ, as we come to the end of our consecration series, now we're going to talk about the rest of the blessings that God gives us. Because God pours out blessing upon blessing upon blessing on our lives every day. And what are we to do as disciples? You could repeat it with me by this point in time, right? We receive the blessing from God, we give him thanks for it, and then we share. That's stewardship. Now, I have to tell you, my personal journey when it comes to stewardship, I grew up in a family that was $1 on the offering plate a week. Anybody else? Anybody else grew up that way? That was the way it was when I was a kid. I watched my parents put in the offering plate every week $1. That was it. Now, some weeks, that offering of $1, that was a tithe. Some weeks, that offering was everything we had to live on. We grew up in a very poor family. And some weeks that dollar was not quite what we could have put in. You know, I grew up that way, and I grew up hearing the annual stewardship sermon that our pastor would give once a year. Bet you probably wish you were in my home church now. And I remember growing up, and when I got to be a pastor, I said, I'm never going to give... You know, I'm never going to talk about stewardship. Never. I hated those sermons. I despised those days. Always felt guilty because our family couldn't give more anyway. I'm never going to preach about stewardship. And then God called me to St. John Battle Creek, where we do a 4 to 6 week stewardship series every year. Thanks, God. I feel like he's laughing at me sometimes. Well, actually, he's taught me some more lessons. I've learned how important stewardship is, not because the church needs money, and I kind of can now understand that Pastor was never preaching about stewardship so he could get a raise. Stewardship is a spiritual issue. God talks about stewardship in such a way that it is vitally important to our discipling relationship with God. Stewardship is important to disciples. A few years ago, about 10 years ago now, I think I've told this story before. I was being interviewed by a recognized service organization of Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, being considered for a director of their organization. And the board that was interviewing me asked me about my ministry financial management philosophy. After looking up three of those words in the dictionary, I responded, "Oh, as a pastor, I talk about stewardship. I let the treasurer talk about money." That wasn't the answer they wanted. Hence why I'm not their director. But money is an important part of stewardship, because giving is an important part of stewardship, because Jesus talks about giving. Jesus makes this something that we just have to talk about. We cannot ignore it. Offering, giving, tithing are a component of stewardship that we cannot ignore. And stewardship is a component of discipleship that we cannot ignore. God loves a cheerful giver. That's what our text from 2 Corinthians tells us today. And I can tell you, every week when my parents put that $1 on the offering plate, the look on their face that I saw was not cheerful. The look I saw on their face was, And I heard someone once say that if, you know, God loves a cheerful giver, if I'm not very cheerful, I'm just not going to give because I don't want to disappoint God with my lack of cheerfulness in my lack of generosity. Let's talk about that for a moment. And I want to draw your attention back to something in the Old Testament. Genesis chapter 4. Remember the story? Cain and Abel. Is that one ringing a bell? Remember what happened, right? Cain works the ground, right? He's a farmer. He grows crops. And Abel's a rancher. He's got meat. And they both bring their offerings to God. And obviously, God is not a vegetarian because he has regard for Abel's offering, but not for Cain's, right? So God likes meat, not the grains. Is that the point of the story? Is that the point? No. If you remember closely what happened, Cain just brings some of the fruit of the ground, some of his offering, whereas Abel brings the first, the fattened calf, the firstborn. He brings the best. Why does God favor Abel's offering over Cain's? It's a gift offered in faith. It's a gift offered in faith. Giving the first and the best, trusting that God will take care of me. Whereas Cain holds on to his best and gives God some leftovers as if I can check off the box and pacify God with something. It's a lack of faith. That's what causes Cain to hold back from God, and it's ultimately what causes Cain to murder his brother and be exiled from God's people. A lack of faith can do that. In our gospel lesson today, we have a widow. All she has to live on are two small copper coins. These two small coins added together, you know, might equal a penny today. As Jesus is sitting there watching people bring their offerings to the temple and dropping their offerings in, he watches rich people bring bags and bags of coins, heaps of cash, hordes of money, and drop it into the offering plate. And it is this woman who brings her two small coins that makes Jesus take notice and tell his disciples, she gave more than all the rest. What's different? She gives by faith. She believes that God is going to take care of her, and so she gives these two small copper coins, trusting that her next meal comes from God. Trusting that her life is going to be sustained by God. Trusting that God is going to take care of her bodily needs, her daily life. Trusting God. The Corinthian Christians have a problem. You see, the church at Jerusalem has been struggling. The saints at Jerusalem suffering from famine, suffering from some disasters, are in great need. And Paul is raising money for the church at Jerusalem. And he's been writing and preaching and teaching and inviting all the saints of God to give for the collection at Jerusalem. And the churches of Macedonia, who are known for being not the greatest of wealth, have given in abundance. They have provided so much for the church at Corinth, sorry, for the church at Jerusalem, but the church at Corinth here, they could have given a lot more. And that's kind of what this chunk of 2 Corinthians is about. It's Paul's invitation for them to give more for the church at Jerusalem, to give more according to their faith. And so Paul's inviting them to give. That's where the context comes from, for God loves a cheerful giver. It's this response of why am I giving? Is it a response driven by faith that trusts and relies on the promises of God? Or is it an offering that is simply given to check the box and say, I gave something? And here's where I have to draw your attention to the prophet Malachi. This verse from Malachi that we read today is one that I didn't hear about it when I was in confirmation class. I don't remember anything ever hearing a sermon about it until later on. When I was at seminary, it was the first time I really remember reading this passage from Malachi. Now, everybody knows what's going to happen in a couple of weeks when we get to the season of Lent and Jesus is out in the wilderness being tempted by Satan, and Satan tells him, right, turn these stones into bread. And Jesus says, man does not live by bread alone. And then Satan says, throw yourself down from here and see if God will send his angels to pick you up. And then Jesus says, is that written? Do not put the Lord your God to the test. Isn't that written somewhere? Of course it is. And we all love to quote that one, right? Don't put God to the test. Did you hear what happened in Malachi today? Did you hear what happened when the prophet Malachi, speaking the words of God, inspired by the Holy Spirit, written for you and for me and for the people of God to hear, he says, God says, put me to the test. Bring in the full tithe, the full offering. Fill up the storehouses of God and see, put me to the test and see if I will not open up the windows of heaven and pour down blessing for you. I love the way he says that. God invites you to test him by tithing. God invites you to test him by tithing, by giving the full 10%, the full first fruits of your income. Test me in this, he says, and see if I will not open up the windows of heaven and pour down blessings for you. Tithing is tough. I told you my story. I grew up in the dollar a week offering plate family. Thanks be to God. I hope they don't watch this. I married into a family that was a little better than that. Not that they made a whole bunch more money, but they taught their family members to tithe a little more. And when Jessica and I got married, and it came time for us to start our offering check writing, I was a dollar a week guy, maybe two, you know, inflation. And she said, we need to tithe. No. We're seminary students. We're living off of food from the food bank. We're melting turkey on our stove, not frying it. Ground turkey from the food bank did not fry. It melted. Okay? We're shopping at the resale shop. We're wearing clothes that people died in 20 years ago. No, we're not going to tithe. And we talked about it more, and we did our best. And sure enough, we started tithing. And I remember how tough it was to write that check. First, we get our paycheck in, and we'd write the 10% tithe check, or we came close to it, we tried, and we would send that, give that to our church. And then, I mean, I know it looks like I'm wasting away here, but, you know, you can only live so long on ramen noodles and tuna casserole. And we write the tithe check, and we'd have to pay the rent, we'd have to pay the electric bill, and we'd have to, you know, take care of the kids and pay for some of the things for them too, and tithe checks. And every time, there was one day I remember vividly, and we were at the bottom of the barrel. We were probably a little below the bottom of the barrel, but I was too ignorant to know it. And we had written the rent check, and we had written the check for the gas bill, and we knew that gas bill was coming, the phone bill was coming. Those checks were waiting. Paycheck came, paycheck was gone. Went out to the mailbox and opened up the mail. Oh, there's that telephone bill we were waiting for. Yep, pay that one. What's this envelope here? Open up the envelope. Cashier's check. $200. Looking all over the envelope for a name. Who's this from? An anonymous donor sent us a cashier's check for $200. And about that time, I was reading Malachi chapter 3, and God connected the dots. Bring in the full tithe and test me. Test me and see if I will not open up the windows of heaven and pour down blessings for you. God has been faithful every time I've tested him. God has provided blessings every time I've looked for him. I have zero doubt that God will give me everything I need to support this body and life. I have no doubt that God will provide for me and for all people, even evil people, daily bread. I believe that God is going to meet every one of these needs. Put God to the test and see if he will open up the windows of heaven. Brothers and sisters in Christ, if you already are tithing, I thank God for the gift of faith he's given you that's led you there. If you're not yet there, I want to encourage you to do what God tells us to do in Malachi. Test him. Now, if you're at the 1% right now, it might be really hard to jump to the 10% today. Maybe try 2 and 4. Work your way up there. But as disciples who follow Jesus, as the children of God who hear God's word and want to follow it and live according to it, disciples as grace-filled givers, I encourage you, invite you to join me and test God. Test him. Put him to the test and see if he will open up the windows of heaven for you. May the peace of God, which passes all of our understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you. Our final lay speaker for this consecration series, again, is Kurt Rogge, who is the chairperson of our congregation's Board of Stewardship. And so I'll invite him forward here and have you make sure the lectern mic is on and put Kurt up on the screen as well.
Grace-filled giving. Our fourth and final week of our stewardship emphasis, Disciples Living as Grace-Filled Stewards, is titled Discipling Grace-Filled Givers. We can learn a lot about the difference between giving by grace through faith and thoughtless giving from studying the lives of Cain and Abel. In Genesis 4, 2 through 4, we read, "Now Abel was a keeper of sheep, and Cain a worker of the ground. In the course of time, Cain brought the Lord an offering of the ground. In the course of fruit from the ground, and Abel also bought the firstborn of his flock and their fat portions. And the Lord had regard for Abel and his offering, but for Cain and his offering he had no regard. The two brothers chose different vocations. Cain tended the soil, and Abel raised sheep. The contrast between the two brothers in their giving is that Cain's offering was thoughtless in that he merely bought some of the fruits of the soil. Abel, on the other hand, by grace through faith, bought the first portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. And because Abel gave the best of his from his heart in true faith as thank offering to God, God was pleased with his offering. Our own offerings will be like Cain's or like Abel's, or fall somewhere between the two of them. Which of the following offerings represents you? Is your giving haphazard or nothing at all? Do you give an offering like Cain without thought, faith, or commitment? Do you give an offering like Abel, sacrificially, with faith and love, acknowledging God as the Lord of your life? With God's help, we can be givers like Abel, who worship God through his giving." Thank you.
Please rise for prayer. Each petition will end with, "Lord, in your mercy," and the congregation will respond with, "Hear our prayer." Let us pray for all people according to their need and for the whole church of God. Lord, in your mercy. Father, thank you for teaching us how to be cheerful givers. Thank you for gifting to us all things needed for this life and the next. We are most grateful for the gifts of faith and salvation. Thank you for showing us that all things come from you and that we are to give to others as you have taught us. Lord, in your mercy. Jesus, thank you for surrendering your life for ours. Thank you for exchanging our sin-stained lives and giving us new life in you. Thank you for gifting to us your righteousness and your holiness. Jesus, help us to fulfill our role as cheerful givers and faithful stewards of the gifts you have given to us to manage on your behalf, Lord, in your mercy. Holy Spirit, as you do your work in us, we ask for your touch both in body and soul. For Bruce G. facing surgery. For Jane Warnke recovering from a neurological incident. For all those struggling with COVID. For our child care families and staff. For our school families and staff. For Linda B., who is recovering at home from surgery last week, and her daughter Tammy. For Marty, who is at home recovering from his procedures. For the mission of St. John, Battle Creek, to be ambassadors and stewards for Jesus. For the sick, for those printed in the bulletin, the elderly, and all those we name in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. for the underemployed, the unemployed, the homeless, and all those affected by the pandemic. For our troops, our police, our firefighters, and all those who put themselves in harm's way to protect us. For our country and its leaders at the federal, state, and local levels, that you would make them mindful of their position because you have placed them there to serve you, your creation. For Pastor Harrison, Pastor Snow, and for all church workers, that they would rely on you for the strength and the wisdom to evangelize your church in this area of stewardship. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. At this time, I invite you to take out your communion cups with the wafer side up. Don't peel the foil back just yet. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you." In the same way also, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, "Take and drink. This is my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. At this time now, I invite you to pull the foil back. Take and eat the body of Christ given for you. Flip the cup over. Take and drink the blood of Christ shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. This do in remembrance of me as often as you drink of it. Now may this true body and blood strengthen you to life everlasting, keeping the one true faith. Depart in peace. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, Redeemer of the world, we thank you for the body and blood of your Son, forgiving our sins and restoring our relationship with you for eternity. Let this true heavenly food and drink fuel us to live as disciples and as grace-filled stewards for the good of your kingdom here on earth, and the glory of your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen.
Righteousness, righteousness is what I long for. Righteousness is what I need. Righteousness, righteousness is what you want from me. So take my heart and form it. Take my mind, transform it. Take my will, conform it to yours, to yours, O Lord. Holiness, holiness is what I long for.
You may be seated. Again, good morning. Words of welcome to each and every one of you here this morning. Pray God has blessed you through our time together in worship today. A few announcements to share with you. Education hour today, adult Bible class in the parish hall. 7th and 8th grade girls are in here. This is our girls' week for confirmation class. Any 7th grade boys who did come for class today, we're going to ask you and your families to go to the adult Bible class today. Otherwise, education, Sunday school over in the school building, usual classrooms today. Wednesday, Bible studies, Wednesday morning, 9:30, women's Bible study with the Wings Group. And also this week, the men's Bible study resumes. Pastor Leach will be leading a men's Bible study Wednesday morning at 9:30. Then I want to make sure that everybody's awake for this announcement. Attention! Attention! Hear ye! Hear ye! Okay, now that I have your attention, this Wednesday, we have a speaker coming here, a licensed mental health practitioner who is going to be talking about children and youth and mental wellness during a pandemic era. Dr. Justin Hanneman, Pastor Justin Hanneman, is going to be here with us on Wednesday night. We're going to serve food at 5:15, and then he's giving two presentations, one at 6, one at 7. 6 o'clock presentation is geared towards parents of children grades 4 and under. And the later presentation, 7 o'clock presentation, is geared for parents of kids who are grades 5 and up. So you have, as a parent, if you're a grandparent to it, and this can be helpful for you, want to invite you to join us here for that presentation. And so we're going to be serving food beforehand, so starting at 5:15. But if you're coming for the 7 o'clock presentation, you can come at 6:15 and eat. You don't have to come at 5:15 and eat and then wait around for an hour. You can come later, eat. We're going to be serving all the way until time for that second presentation to start. And if you need somebody to watch your kids, bring them with you. We'll have people here who can take the kids over to the school, play games over in the school gym or over there in the child care room also. So no excuses for not being here Wednesday night. Encourage you to be here, and I'm going to give you one more little teaser. So Pastor Dr. Hanneman went to college at Concordia Seward, and his roommate was Greg Priner. Okay? So I don't know if he's going to tell you any Greg Priner stories or not. Don't ask him. Okay? Because next time Greg's here, he might tell stories about me, and we don't want that to happen either. All right? So, but interesting fact. Just interesting fact for you. Come here, Justin, talk. Be here Wednesday night. Said food at 5:15, first presentation's at 6, second presentation at 7. One other announcement for you, our contribution statements, giving statements from last year are available down in the entryway of the parish hall. So if you want to check that out, they're filed in the mail slots there. Make sure you grab your giving statement from there. If you can't find yours for whatever reason, give Katie a call in the church office. She'll make sure and get you a copy of your giving statement from last year. Any other announcements? And this day the Lord has blessed us with. May you enjoy with your family and friends. Before we are dismissed from the sanctuary here, we invite you to spend a moment in silent prayer as you ask God to strengthen your faith and help you test him.